lot of the good things that happened under that man's leadership or under that woman's leadership seem to very quickly fade away. This is, for instance, very typical of the book of Judges, right? But I think that this holds true in my experience. There are people around whom it is easy for me to be faithful. It is easier for me to follow the Lord when they are in the room, when they are regularly in my life. And that's not bad. That's fellowship. That's discipleship. That's good. That's a good thing. But we all need to be developing our own personal relationship with the Lord. And I think Moses maybe recognizes or sees this pattern developing in the nation of Israel. And he's like, okay, I'm the one that the Spirit of the Lord is on, and I'm leading these people. And it's like we were at a corn maze on Friday night, and there were a number of activities there, and one of the activities there was a tractor pull, and they had three tractors with these big ropes with knots connected to them, and one of them was like, I don't know, I think it was like 600 pounds, and you could pull that by yourself, and then another one was about 3,500 pounds, and then there was one that was 4,400 pounds, and so of course, all the kids want to test themselves on these things, and they're like, oh, I'm going to go pull a tractor, and they're all like, yeah, I can pull this little one. I'm like, great. Good job. Way to go. And then some of them are wanting to try to pull the bigger ones. And, you know, you try to pull a 4,400-pound tractor by yourself, not much is going to happen. But Alethea, Elise, and I did it. The three of us. We were able to get that thing moving and move it along the track. I couldn't have done it myself. And they couldn't have done it themselves. But the three of us together did manage it. Moses felt like he was pulling that tractor. It was just awful. It was terrible. He thought he felt so alone. Even though the Spirit of God was with him, right? He had a helper that's capable of anything. Pretty fair analogy to our lives. But God says, I'm going to give you 70 people to pull the tractor with you. I'm gonna send you help. And then by the end of the chapter, what is Moses like? Hey, let's just have everyone pull the tractor. I want the Spirit of God to be upon everyone. And I'm not going to go into the weeds on what is meant and whether or not there are any implications to the ministry of the Holy Spirit in this passage. But the idea is Moses doesn't see himself as the essential leader. He sees God as the essential leader in every person's life. I want these people following God, not me. All of us, one way or another, are in a position of leadership in our lives right now, or will be. We're going to end up leading people somewhere. You need God's Holy Spirit active in your life, submitted to in your life, accessed through the Word in your life, if you want to be pulling the tractor in the right direction. And as we together as a body of Christ are submitted to the Holy Spirit and we're all pulling in the same direction, then we get so much more work done than we could if we were just trying to go it alone. And that's not a rebuke. I think that in a lot of ways, we as a church do that very well. We need to not stop doing it. And we need to not be selfish about the parts that we do. We all need to be involved. We need to be working together toward the glory of God. And that's what Moses wants by the end of the chapter. He's like, okay, great. I don't need this responsibility. I don't need to stand on this pedestal. I'll take it. I'll take everyone. I wish that's the way it was. And brothers and sisters, his wish came true, sort of. Because in the church, we are all indwelt by the Holy Spirit. And we have an opportunity to experience a kind of unity and fellowship that was not possible, but for which Moses dearly wished. So, God here, through this promise, provides for Moses help that he really needed. People to help him, to pull with him. And additionally, God promises, when you gather them, I'm going to come down and I'm going to speak with them. Now that's actually a really scary thing for these people, right? The last time God came down and spoke with them, they said, Moses, we're delegating this to you. You go talk to God and tell us what God said. We're not really into that. And God basically says, okay, fine. They don't get that anymore. I'm going to at least have these 70 come and I'm going to speak to them. So God here is beginning to lift the burden that's on Moses. He's giving him real help. Now, he doesn't remove the burden, but he begins to lift the burden. And I think we can take from this by way of application that God is not unaware of our struggles. A lot of the time when we're in the midst of a trial, we think and say things in our prayers like, God, do you even care? And that's like saying, God, do you know? Do you actually know what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling, my perception of what I'm going through? And yes, of course he does. He's not responding. He's not reflexively dealing with things as if things are out of control. He is proceeding at a measured pace through our times to bring us under the image of Christ. Nothing is a surprise to him. And what is in your life is his will for your good and his glory. That doesn't mean that you're expected to like it, but you are expected to be thankful for it and to rejoice in it. And that's hard work, I know. God is not unaware of your struggles, nor does he send us trials in a capricious way. James 1 gives us his purposes in our trials. And God, in the trials that he sends our way, does not leave us without help. We have one another in this fellowship and other brothers and sisters in Christ with whom we have developed relationships over the years that are not part of this fellowship, but nevertheless are part of our circle. God has given us brothers and sisters that can strengthen, encourage, and help us. We have one another. We have God's word. We have enough here in the Bible to have what we need to live lives of righteousness, of godliness in this present age. God's word is sufficient to help us in our problems, to encourage us in our griefs, and to be all sufficient in the various difficulties of our lives. We have one another. We have God's word. We have God's grace to encounter the trials of our lives and to come out the other side conformed to the image of Christ. And as I've already spoken of, we have the Holy Spirit who through his word speaks with us. So God brings relief to heavy burdens in verses 16 and 17. But also in 18 through 20, God grants a request to teach better desires. Verse 18 and following, and say to the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow you shall eat meat. For you have wept in the hearing of the Lord, saying, who will give us meat to eat? For it was better for us in Egypt. Therefore the Lord will give you meat, and you shall eat. You shall not eat just one day, or 2 days, or 5 days, or 10 days, or 20 days, but a whole month, until it comes out your nose, and becomes loathsome to you, because you have rejected the Lord who is among you, and have wept before him, saying, why did we come out of Egypt? God grants a request here to teach better desires. Do you see the lowness of these people's desires, the impulses which they wish to gratify over and above the excellence that they have been given? They have been given the right and the opportunity to be the people of God, to be blessed and protected in ways that no other people of God have ever experienced. And they've already had a foretaste of this in the way that they were delivered from Egypt, in their traveling across the wilderness, in God's provision for them throughout their time at the mountain, and in his giving of the law and his promises of blessing. All of these things they'd experienced in ways that no other people had ever experienced. And after having been given all of those glorious gifts and the promises that they should have believed would come and follow as they continued on, they said, we miss our food. We want to go back to slavery and sin because we miss our food. How low is that? And yet, brothers and sisters, I am that low in my sin. You are that low in your sin and in your unbelief. We have been given more than these people. We have been given, through Jesus Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, we have been given membership, adoption into the very family of God, wherein Jesus Christ is our older brother. And he's not ashamed to call us brother or sister. We have been given the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. We have been given the full 66 books of God's Word. We have been given so much. And yet we have the lowness of faith, the baseness of desires to go back to our sin, which is a fair analogy to these people saying, we miss our food. And I understand that. I like my food. I really do. I enjoy eating. And I enjoy lots of different kinds of food. And if I don't get my food, you might catch me being a little grumpy. Pretty good chance of that. It's like a little more than might. Pretty good chance that I'll get a little grumpy. We have expectations. When those expectations aren't fulfilled, those things become huge in our minds. And the huge things, God's good gifts, become minuscule, become so small by comparison. That is idolatry. That is worshiping something more than God has told us we should. It is elevating above what it ought to be. A good gift that God has given us. Or taking it in a time or in a way or in a place that is outside the boundaries of obedience. And this is what the people of Israel were doing. So God grants a request to teach better desires. God shows that he can fulfill Israel's desires, but on terms that he is not involved in. He says, you want food? I'll give it to you on your own terms. And you'll see what self-indulgence looks like and the consequences of it. And so, let me suggest, brothers and sisters, by way of application here, be careful what you wish for. If you're wishing for something that is not connected to your relationship with the Lord, if you're praying to God for something that you really, really want, but it's just a selfish desire, I'm afraid God might give it to you. Because it is more important for you to learn what self-indulgence does to you than anything else at that point. And that's what happens to the people of Israel here. God will sometimes allow us to pursue what will harm us, to give us the lesson that obedience and enjoyment of his good gifts within the boundaries of obedience is the best way to live. Staying in God's will and enjoying what is within the boundaries of obedience is the safest way to live. Enjoy life to the fullest. In a context of obedience and the fear of the Lord, the book of Ecclesiastes. And you will have a life that is significant with joy and peace and hope. Not easy, perhaps. But all those other things. However, if we cry after our own desires, God may grant our request and send leanness to our soul. Has your soul been feeling lean? Do you feel like God's not there, or I don't understand? It may be that he has granted a desire of yours, and you're reaping the result of an ungodly desire. So God shows that he can fulfill desires even in allowing us to have what we want that is not good for us. And when we indulge ourselves like that, we take into ourselves poison for our bodies and poison for our souls. Contentment is much better than petulant demands granted by way of a hard lesson learned. And yet that is what happens to the people of Israel here. God even warns them. Did you catch that there? In verse 18, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow you shall eat meat. Set yourselves apart. Be very careful how you eat meat tomorrow. Consecrate yourself. Get ready. I'm sending a test. Be careful. Just, he sets them up to succeed. Make sure your heart is right before the quail shows up. That's not how it turns out, as we very well know, and we'll look at next week, Lord willing. But he warns them. He sets them up to succeed, and yet they still fail, even as we do. So, just a really important lesson there in the way that he's dealing with them. He's setting them up for success. He's moving them on a spectrum from faithlessness and discontent to thankfulness and obedience and faith. And yet, the people of Israel and us, we are so resistant to that process. So consecrate yourselves, set yourselves apart, and when you weep for something, don't weep for my food, don't weep for the fleshly desire that you feel like you have to have or you just can't go on, because God may give it to you and you're going to find out, no, I didn't really need that, in fact, I didn't even want it, because after a month, I was sick of it anyways. That's what sin is like. I need God. Well, Moses goes on in 21 through 23. Moses says, the people among whom I am numbered 600,000 on foot, and yet you have said, I will give them meat that they may eat a whole month. Shall flocks and herds be slaughtered, and that be enough for them? Or shall the fish of the sea be gathered, and that be enough for them? And the Lord said to Moses, is the Lord's hand shortened? Now you shall see whether my word will come true for you or not. So here we have the whole people of Israel just piling onto Moses as God's representative, just whining and complaining at God through Moses. That was the poor guy's life. That's how it operated there for all these years. And Moses is just like, I can't take this anymore. This is the previous paragraph from last week. God, I can't take this anymore. If this is how it's going to go, just kill me. I want to be done with this. And God says, no, Moses, that's not the solution to this issue. I'm going to send you some helpers. And these 70 men are going to come alongside you and they're going to help you pull. They will filter some of that complaining. They will deal with it before it gets to you. They will help you out. That's the promise of God. And additionally, I'm going to give these people the meat that they're asking for. Everybody gets what they want. And Moses says, God, I don't think you can do that. How is that going to happen? Tell me, God, are you going to magic some herds and flocks into existence around us here so that we can slaughter them? Are you going to cast a great net into the sea and bring all the fish from the Mediterranean Sea and dump them over the camp? Is that how you're going to do it? I don't think you can do this, God. I mean, it feels like he's waxing sarcastic. I think this is where he's so much like us. Anyone here ever been in a bad mood? Okay, you don't have to raise your hands. And you know that you shouldn't be, and someone tells you that you shouldn't be, and someone actually cajoles you and confronts you and tries to help you, and you're like, no, I want to stay grumpy. Ooh, got some really good head shakes from the front row there. I think Moses is just kind of in the grumps here. No, God, I want to stay grumpy. You're not. What? Come on. How are you going to do this? And what's sadly hilarious, that doesn't make any sense, but what doesn't make sense here is that we know very well that not too far into the past, God had sent quail at another time and in another place. We're not going to have time to go there this morning. I was going to, but I don't think we have time. But Exodus 16 is another account. It's the whole manna being introduced account, but God also sends quail in that instance. And that was not too long in the past. This shouldn't have escaped Moses' mind that God is capable of doing this. So no, God isn't going to magic herds into place, and he's not going to cast a great net into the Mediterranean Sea and dump fish all over the camp. But he has done something very like that. He sent quail by the millions to surround the camp once before. It's going to happen again. And it didn't occur to Moses that it could happen again. When we get grumpy in our complaining, in our unfaith, in our discontent with God's will, we get very forgetful of his works in the past. And we say really stupid things. We say them to God. We say them to the people around us while we're complaining. We forget the works of God. And forgetting the works of God results in faithlessness. We stop affirming that God is good. We stop believing that God is good when we forget his good works for us. Moses forgot the works of God. How? I don't know. The people of Israel forgot the works of God. How? I don't know. But brothers and sisters, I forget the works of God. And I sure shouldn't. Even the best of men, Moses is one of the most faithful, powerfully used men of God in all times. Even the best of men fail in their faith. Moses' lament from last week, his comments here show us that. God has provided in the past. He has made promises about the future. If he has provided in the past and has made promises about the future, it is absolutely essential that we have faith in God, in his goodness, that he will keep his promises. We need to have faith. God deserves that. We have no right to withhold that from him. He has kept his promises in the past. He has given us glorious promises concerning the future. Our present and into our future, near distance future, middle distance future, eternity, all of these things. God deserves our faith and our obedience. It's hard to do that when you're hungry, when you don't have your food, or whatever else it is that we are tempted to complain about. We need, in the midst of our struggle of unbelief, we need to remember the works of God. Because then if we're remembering the works of God, we will reflect on his promises in the present, and it will result in a change of, it can result in a change of heart about the future. Looks like Moses gets it. As we look at the rest of the passage, God rebukes him. The Lord said to Moses in verse 23, is the Lord's hand shortened? You really think I can't do this, Moses? Come on. Remember my works. Remember how long my arm was in Egypt, how strong my hand was at the Red Sea. Do you think I've got weaker since then, Moses? Do you really think that? It's a rhetorical question. The answer in Moses' mind was, no, of course not. So God keeps his promises. Moses obeys in verse 24. He went out and told the people, gathered the elders, and the Lord came down in verse 25 and spoke, and the elders are all there, and they prophesied. Okay? So the Spirit of the Lord is promised earlier in the passage. The Spirit of the Lord is going to come upon them, and then proof of that promise is brought out in the way that these men prophesy. They actually do something out of the ordinary, and I don't know exactly what that is in this context, but it was something that was extraordinary, that was an event that didn't happen with regularity, because we see there that they did not continue doing it at the end of verse 25, right? So there was something extraordinary that happened in the way that these men behaved when the Spirit of the Lord came upon them. They spoke something. They said things. Even the ones that didn't show up. God perforce required Eldad and Medad to be part of this group, even though they were sent for and didn't show. There's all kinds of interesting speculation about what was going on there. I prefer to just let it pass. Maybe they were sick. Maybe word didn't get to them, but maybe they were openly against Moses and they didn't want to be associated with this group. I don't know. Whatever it was that kept them away from the official gathering that they were commanded by God through Moses to attend some way or another, perforce, they prophesied in the camp. And boy, I'm with the young man who tattled. I'm with Joshua, who was like, Moses, tell these guys to be quiet. They didn't even come to the meeting. Because I'm a pretty straight-laced guy. You know, do things in the right way. Do them in the right order. Do them on time. Do them early. Do these things in the right way. And these guys, they're like, nah, we got options. We've got options. And obeying Moses and obeying God through Moses, that's optional. And yet still, they prophesied in the camp. And Joshua and this young man are like, no, they shouldn't be doing that. And Moses' response at the end of it all is, I need the Spirit of God. I had a little complaint fest a couple paragraphs ago. I actually got sarcastic with God and said, I don't think you can do this, even though I knew he could do it. And I was just kind of holding on to my grumpiness, my unbelief, my complaining heart. At the end of the day, Moses is like, no, we all need this. We all need to be pulling in the same direction. I wish everyone was. These people who caused me so many problems, these people who are such a drag on me, if only all of them were blessed by the Spirit of God in a way similar to me. I would take that. So, chapter starts off with problems. Fire in the camp. Unbelief. Moses responds poorly. The people of Israel respond poorly. The outlying parts of the camp that aren't part of Israel, they are maybe proselytizing toward Israel. They're at the very least traveling with them under the aegis, under the protection of Jehovah. These people are acting poorly. And everyone has got this fellowship of complaining going on. They're all working it together. And God, in his provisions and his warnings in these paragraphs, is giving him an opportunity to move on a spectrum away from discontentedness, faithless hearts, toward thankfulness and faith and obedience. And some of them do move on the spectrum in the right direction. And as we'll see next week, most of them don't. And there's actually a pretty tragic event that occurs in the history of the nation of Israel because of their lack of faith. But we have here this event that shows that God makes promises and God keeps them. And it's optional whether or not we are going to be putting our faith in God. We know his works in the past. Some of those works are personal. Many of them are just on record. Right? We've got the works of God in his word, and we've got the works of God in our lives and in the lives of the people that are around us. They're all works of God. We've got his deeds in the past. We have his promises regarding our present, our near, our middle, and our distant future. We need to respond to the things that could activate that subtext of discontent in our mind and make our whole context one of complaining. We need to use those times to be speaking to God in faith. God, I don't like this. I don't know what's going on. Give me the grace to have faith, a thankful heart, and obedience, even though I just want to hold on to my complaining. Because it's fun to complain. It's easy to complain. And complaining is a kind of fellowship, but it's not a godly fellowship. And so let us not have a fellowship of complaining. Let us have a fellowship of contentment. And a fellowship that is full of thankfulness because of what God has done in the past and what we believe because of his record he will do in the near, in the middle, and in the distant future. May we all be moving on the spectrum in the direction that Moses moved. Faith, thankfulness, and a determination to hold on to our relationship with the Lord. Thank you, Father, for your goodness to us and for these good examples in your word. May our hearts be turned to you. May we see that as much as we want our food, whatever it is, whatever pleasure it is that's distracting us from obedience right now, you are our greatest treasure. That through Jesus Christ we have the best gift, the best relationship, the best context for living that anyone could have. And so we may we pursue you instead of our pleasures. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please stand with me as we sing the last few verses of Jesus, the Very Thought of Thee.